Yeah, all right, so now we're recording. So everybody knows we're recording. So I want to talk about conditional probability, and then I'm going to use that topic to talk about the multiplication rule again with the formula. And then I'm going to talk about the probability of at least one. And then we'll do examples where I'm sure the addition rule will pop up and all that stuff. Conditional probability, this is a new notation. So this is a vertical line here. It's not a fraction bar, it's a vertical line. And the vertical line implies conditional probability. And we read it as given. So we would read this as the probability of A given B, which means this is the probability of event A occurring given event B has already occurred. So, has already occurred. I'm sorry, I'm not usually this sloppy. Okay. You could read it though, right? Probability of event A occurring given event B has already occurred. So, we kind of did a little bit of this yesterday, just with not the formula or with the actual terms of conditional probability, because we did talk about a situation where we calculated a probability within the multiplication rule of an event occurring after another event has already occurred. So, like, if you remember yesterday, we did a standard deck of cards and we talked about selecting more than one card. And whenever we're selecting more than one, we always have to think about the multiplication rule. And when I think about the multiplication rule, I always consider whether or not I have, you know, independent or dependent events. So I did an example of both. The first one, I selected two cards at random, and I wanted the probability of getting two queens, where I go to this deck and I select one, put it back with replacement, and then select the next one. So because of the fact that I put that queen back before I selected the second one, I had independent events. The probability was not affected. So when we calculated that, you know, four queens out of 52 total cards, because I put the queen back, I had also four queens out of 52 cards. Now, these are independent events. So if I go back to, not the addition rule here, and I'm going to talk about this notation and such. That's kind of like this particular situation. We just multiply the two probabilities. Where'd it go? But the second one, I did it without replacement. We selected three cards and we did it without replacement. And, you know, because I did it without replacement, the probability of the second event and the third event was affected by what happened prior. And so, you know, we saw a decrease in some of the numbers. So we call, that's a conditional type of situation. Like, this is the second event, selecting another queen under the condition that I already selected a queen without replacing it. Here's another, selecting a queen under the condition or given that I had already selected queen. So this is an example of conditional probability. Also, it's just that, you know, I didn't use the notation and I didn't necessarily talk about it until today. But we did, you know, talk about it just intuitively, right? Now I'm going to show you ways to do conditional probability where you can avoid using the formula or you can use the formula, right? That you could get the same response either way. But the reason that I'm showing the formula is there are some problems in either assignment yesterday or today where they're asking you to basically use the formula, in other words. So, I'm going to do it, I guess, with a standard deck of cards just to make it a little bit easier because we're used to cards right now. Let's see if there's another one in here. Boxes. This is kind of like, I want it to have. All right, I'll do a standard deck of cards. So again, standard deck of cards, where is it? 52 total cards, four suits, diamonds, spades, hearts, and clubs. So that means there's 13 of each suit. Diamonds and hearts are red, 26 total red, spades and clubs are black, 26 total black cards, and then you have cards number from 2 to 10 of each suit, so there's 4 twos, 4 threes, 4 fours, 4 fives, 4 sixes, blah. And then you have jacks, queens, kings, and aces, which are like special, also of each suit, so 4 jacks, 4 queens, 4 kings, 4 aces, right? A jack of diamonds, a jack of spades, a jack of hearts, blah. And the jack, queen, kings are called the face cards. So there's 12 total of those. So that's just the recap of that yesterday. And I want to use a standard deck of cards to talk about conditional probability. And I want to do it where I do it without the formula. And then I'm going to show you with the formula and I can get the same thing. But I want you to know how to use the formula also because of the fact that I'll do an example from the assignment where it does require the formula. But that actually is even easier. Okay, actually, so standard deck of cards, I'm going to randomly, let's start with example A. I'm going to randomly select one card, and I want the probability of getting an ace given a diamond. Okay, so I'm going to do a conditional probability situation where I'm using the notation. You're not always going to be using the notation, but you want to be able to convert the notation to words and vice versa. So this is the probability of selecting an ace given that a diamond has already been, or given that we have diamonds under the condition that it's a diamond. There's a little bit of a backwards concept here, and again, this is not a fraction bar. Do not confuse this with a fraction bar. It's not a fraction bar. It's kind of backwards a little bit in the sense that this is kind of happening first, or this is the situation first, and out of this then we talk about this. So find the probability of selecting an ace out of the diamonds. Find the probability of selecting an ace given that it is a diamond. In other words, find the probability of selecting an ace out of the diamonds. So if I'm doing this without the formula, right, I typically go, all right, well, this is kind of what it's out of. So now this is affecting the denominator here. It's no longer out of 52 cards. It's now out of diamonds because it's given that we're talking about diamonds. Out of the diamonds, what's the probability I get an ace? So I have to think about how many diamonds there are. It's no longer out of 52 cards. How many diamonds do I have? You can answer if you want. I'll check the chat too. How many diamonds do I have in my standard deck of cards?
Is that 13?
Mm-hmm. I have 13 total diamonds. So I'm going to say out of 13 total diamonds, what's the probability I get an ace? Well, how many aces are in that section of diamonds? I only have one ace of diamonds. This is like the intersection of the two, ace of diamonds. There's only one ace of diamonds. So there's only one out of 13 for this probability. What's the probability I randomly select one ace given that it's a diamond? What's the probability of selecting an ace out of the diamonds? There's one ace in my diamond group out of 13 total diamonds, and there's my probability, which I don't know what that is in decimal form, 1 out of 13, which is point, and I guess we're usually 4 decimals, 0.0769, right? 0.0769, and then you can convert that to percentage if you want. Tell me if that makes sense or if you have questions real quick, because I'm going to do that same problem with the formula. Actually, before I do with the formula, I might do another one. Tell me if you have questions. before I do another one real quick. And actually, I might have you try the next one. So I'm going to randomly select one card. And I want the probability that I randomly select a king, given that the card is black. Try it for a second. So find the probability that I randomly select a king given that the card is black. Given that it's black. So in other words, out of black cards, what's the probability I get a king? So you have to think about how many black cards we have.
Is that 126? 1 over 26?
Exactly. 26 black cards, and only one of them is king. 1 out of 26, which is, I don't know, whatever that is, 0.0385. Approximately 0.0385. Okay. So again, find the probability I randomly select a king given that it's black. So it has to be a black card, 26 of them. What's the probability that out of those black, it's a king? 1. So the denominator is, you know, kind of a new situation here because it's out of this. And then the numerator is the intersection. So look, check out the formula. Find the probability of A given B. This is the probability of A and B. This is the intersection, which if you're not familiar with that notation, that's what this is, intersection. It's like saying and over the probability of B. Notice that this is always down here. Now the formula, I'm going to use the formula to do the same thing, let's say, the same one here. And you can do it either way. I personally think this is faster if you don't need to use the formula. But like I said, there's going to be a situation where you have to use the formula. So I'm going to show you that too. Right there. Is it that one? No. Okay. So let's do it using the formula. Using the formula. So I'm going to rewrite the formula. Probability of A given B is equal to, this is a vertical line, the probability of A and B, the intersection of the two, over the probability of B. That's the formula. And in this particular example, if I'm comparing it to what I have here, I want the probability of getting a king given a black card. So if you want to think about it as king is taking the place of the A and black is taking the place of event B. So if I'm rewriting the formula, this is the probability of A and B, king and black, or, you know, a black card that is a king, over probability of B, where black cards took the place of B, probability of black card. And if I'm doing it using the formula, I'm going to get the same thing, just a little bit longer. Now, focus on the two of these separately, because if you look at all of it in one shot, it's going to be overwhelming. So I'm going to start by just looking at the numerator for a second, king and black. Probability of that out of the total cards. Now, these each are out of the total cards. Probability of getting a black king card out of the total cards is one king that's black. We made a mistake earlier. How many black cards are king? 2. We made a mistake. And the reason we made a mistake is because it was black and not diamond. There's 2 black king cards because I have a king of clubs and a king of spades. So I made an error here because I forgot that there are 2 black king cards. Same idea. What's the probability of a king given that it's black out of the black cards, how many of them are king? Two, not one. We made that error. So wait, let me fix that. Actually, it's the same thing as the above one, 0.0769. So I made that error. Let me know if you guys see the error that I made. And if it makes sense that that was an error and why. Right? Two black cards. This is black. These are diamond. This is black cards. Two kings that are black. It's not out of a suit. It's out of total blacks. Okay. All right, so when I'm doing this, probability of a king and black out of the total, there are two cards that are king and black out of the 52 total cards. This fraction bar is a division bar, right? A fraction bar is division. So I'm dividing by the probability of black. And I have 26 total black cards out of 52. Obviously, I have to do another one of these. When I'm dividing these two, dividing fractions, I keep the first, I flip the second, and I change to multiplication. And so the 52s cancel, and I get 2 out of 26, which is what I got up here. Which this is obviously a little bit more effort and a little bit more work, but I do get the same thing, right? So wait, stop me if you have a question. I did the same thing. Obviously I messed up here because I forgot that there were two black king cards, which actually this helped me indicate that I made an error, but does it make sense? So I can use the formula or I can kind of do it intuitively unless I'm forced to use the formula, which this one forces me to use the formula. So pop, like ask me questions if you're stuck. Oh, sorry, Jennifer. I'm gonna do another one. And actually I'm gonna take it from the assignment that says you have 8 green cards and 5 yellow cards. Okay, so it's not a regular deck of cards. You have 8 green cards and 5 yellow cards. The cards are well shuffled. You randomly draw 2 cards. You're selecting 2 cards without replacement. They define G1 to be the event where the first card is green.
Do you have questions on the chat?
Let me check. Just wondering why 52 when the question was about. Okay. This is using the formula, and this one is using intuition, right? You're completely right. We're going probability of a king given that it's black. So out of black cards, what's the probability that it's king? This is a quicker way of doing the formula. But the formula, when you're actually calculating it here, these little pieces that you're doing up here, probability of, so you're following the formula, you're doing the probability of A and B, the intersection. This is out of the total now. There's no given in this one, right? This is just A and B out of the total. This is the probability of B out of the total. So if I'm doing the process using the formula, probability of a king and a black card out of the total, there's no given situation in this particular portion of the formula. This particular portion of the formula allows me to calculate the given situation, but this particular portion of the formula is just a probability of an intersection out of a total. There's no given within this. Does that make sense? Why it's not the 26 and over here it's out of 52? Same thing with this one. This is the probability of a black card, period, here. Just this portion by itself. There's no given here. This is just probability of a black card, period. That's out of the total 52. That's why these particular, so this represents the numerator and this represents the denominator, and I'm dividing the two, which will at the end of the day give me the same thing that I did up here, which is faster. So I'm doing it two different ways, but I'm doing the same thing two different ways. So I'm gonna do, I'll do another example with this problem from the actual assignment, and I'll do it both ways also, okay? I'll do it like with the formula, and I'll do it like just intuitively. And then I'm gonna show you a case where you have to use the formula. And if we need to go back to deck of cards, we can and practice that again. Second card is green. I'll show you as many as I need to. It just takes practice. And they have, this is part C, the probability of G2 given G1. Okay? This is the conditional case for that one. And I'm going to replace, you know, this with the events here. So the probability of getting a green card given a green card has already been selected.
Are both of them supposed to be green?
Yeah. Yeah. Given green card has already been selected. So. This is an interesting one. Probably should have done the multiplication rule here. This is an example of the multiplication rule because I want to select a green card given that I have already selected a green card. This is another way of looking at the multiplication rule because I'm selecting two. So in other words, I'm going to come back to the multiple. I have to come back to the deck of cards to get a conditional again. I'm going to select a green card and then select another green card. And I'm glad I did this. I get questions about this one all the time, and this is another way of asking something like related to the multiplication rule with conditional cases. But it kind of like, you don't even need the formula for this one. You can just use the multiplication rule because I'm selecting two cards rather than one. So I want the first card to be green and then another green card, but the given portion is indicating that I have selected a green card first, and then given I'm selecting a green card second. So I'm selecting a green card and then I'm selecting another green card. Let that go. So this is like what we did yesterday. I want to select a green card first, and there are 8 green cards out of 13 total cards, because 8 + 5 total cards. But the second event has to happen under the condition that this was green, which I'm not replacing it. And so now there are only 7 green cards out of 12. So they use the conditional notation, but because I'm selecting two cards, it's a little bit different than this one where I'm selecting one card. And I'm conditional. This is why I wanted to do conditional today and not necessarily, but we kind of did conditional situations when we did the multiplication rule up here. Probability of A and B, probability of A times the probability of B given A. But we didn't go through the formula. So this was a little bit different. Let me come back to this one. All right, I'm bouncing around. I thought that was the same thing, but it wasn't. I'm sorry. All right, let's do this one together. I'm going to randomly select one card, and I'm selecting one, and I want the probability that that one card from a standard deck of cards is a jack given clubs. All right. Now, we are going to do this together because I want to make sure you're following me. And we're going to do this one together. And I'm going to do it intuitively. And then we'll do it with the formula. And hopefully you'll see why sometimes the formula will be out of the total, as what she said before, too. So, you guys, I want the probability. I'm selecting one card. What is the probability that the one card is a jack, given that it's a club? So in other words, what is this probability going to be out of? Because I'm only selecting one card this time. There's no multiplication rule if I'm selecting one card. What is it out of? Is it out of the total? Or is it out of something else? What's my denominator here?
Is it 13? Because there's, I clearly don't know my deck of cards, but.
Yes, because 13. You have 13 of each of these, what we call suits, 13 clubs. Clubs are black. So I have 13 total because I want it out of clubs, right? Jack, given that it's a club. So 13 clubs. How many of the clubs are jacks?
One.
Notice that this is what I did earlier when I messed up here. There's one ace of diamond, but there were two black cards that were kings. This one is out of clubs. There's only one jack of clubs. So find the probability that one card is selected and that one card is a jack, given that it's out of clubs, given that it's a club. So there's one jack of clubs out of total clubs. And then whatever that decimal is, right? I'm going to have to ask you another one. I'm going to randomly select one card again. And I want the probability that that one card is randomly making it up, a five, has a five on it, given that it is a red card. So let's talk about that. Just intuitively, right? Find the probability that I randomly select one card, and that one card is a five, given that it's red. So now how many, or what am I out of here, given that it's red? How many red cards? Where's my thing? Here. 26? 26, thank you.
26.
Awesome. 26 total red. How many red cards, or how many fives are red? Intersection of the two. How many fives are red?
Two.
This was the mistake we did before, right? Because there's two of each color. Right? Because there's a five that is a diamond, which is red, and a five that is a heart, which is also red. So there's two cards that are red. So if I want the probability, I select one card, and that one card is a five, given that it's red. Well, there's two fives out of 26 total reds. And then that simplifies to one out of 13, whatever that is. Okay, you with me? Now, I'll do the same thing using the formula, which I usually hate to do unless I have to, just because it's longer, right? I'm gonna show you though, I'll get the same thing using formula. Where? The formula, I'll write it here. Probability of A given B is equal to the probability of A and B intersection over the probability of B. This is always matching kind of that. What's already happened. And I need to move this down more. Okay, So in this particular example up here, A is taking the place of Jack, or Jack is taking the place of A, and then, you know, B's in the place of clubs. So the probability of a Jack, given that I want clubs, is equal to the probability of Jack and club over the probability of B, which is clubs. Now, when I calculate, bring this down here, when I calculate this portion, each of these probabilities separately, I'm looking at this one by itself, this is no longer given. This particular, if I ignore everything else is gone, cover up everything else. Probability of a Jack and club, that's out of my total. There's no given in this particular part of the formula. So the probability of getting a Jack and a club, Jack of clubs, there's only one Jack of clubs out of 52 total cards. But remember that this fraction bar is division. And then the probability of clubs, what's the probability of clubs? How many clubs do I have? Probability of clubs is 13 out of 52. And when I use division, I keep the first, I flip the second, and I change the multiplication, and I get the same thing that I had without going through all this. That's why I don't like using the formula if I don't have to, because I could do it intuitively, right? Let me know if it makes sense. You know, like doing it intuitively versus the formula. Let me know if there are any questions. So far, so good. If there are no questions, so far, so good. I'm checking the chat too. I'm gonna expand on this real quick. And I want you to see the difference, because I kind of threw this other one in there. If I randomly select two cards, okay, this is a big difference. Now I'm randomly selecting two or more than one. I want to find the probability that I get an ace card given. Okay, I'm gonna mess with you a little bit. Okay, king. And this is without replacement, because I'm talking about conditional probability. So I want to select two cards now. And anytime I'm selecting more than one, this is where what I did here was a little bit different. Down here, right? This was a little bit different, even though it had conditional notation, I was selecting two cards. So I approached it a little bit differently. I'm selecting two cards. I'm going to approach it a little bit differently. Now I'm going to interpret it as probability of getting an ace on the first card given a king. I'm sorry, probability of getting an ace on the second card given a king was first selected. In other words, find the probability of an ace being selected given a king was selected. Or you want to select a king, then an ace. Given a king has been selected, the king is first, even though, you know, it looks vice versa here. This is not a fraction bar. This is a given conditional notation, probability of an ace given a king. But I'm selecting two cards. So now I'm going to approach it with the multiplication rule. It's a little bit different because I'm selecting more than one. Tell me if that makes sense, that you see the difference when I'm selecting more than one versus one. Or if you have questions about the difference. Remember, I always multiply two events when I'm dealing with more than two, right? Selecting more than one. Every time I'm multiplying, I'm always selecting more than one. I'm selecting two cards, multiply two events. Selecting three cards, multiply three. But I'm using the notation for conditional probability to ask the same question. Find the probability of getting an ace given it's a king, given the first card was a king. So I want to select the king first. Then I want to select, the ace. So, I want to move this down for a second if I can, because I'm going to write little notes underneath. Okay. So I'm going to write a note here. First event, selecting king. Second event, selecting an ace after the king, given a king has already been selected. Well, let's see. Probability of selecting a king, 4 out of 52. I'm not replacing the king. What's changing in the deck? If I'm not selecting the king, obviously, I'm sorry, if I'm not replacing the king, obviously I don't have as many kings, but I don't want to select the king again. I want to select an ace. So that's not affecting the aces.
But your deck is no longer 52, it's 51.
But I have 51 cards instead of 52. So now I want an ace, but I had already selected a king. Right, under the condition that a king has already been selected. And so I kept that king, so now there's 51 cards. And this one I'll do on my calculator. So you have 4 out of 52 times 4 out of 51. 0.0060. This is an extremely small probability because if you think about it in percentage form, this is 0.6%. I would say it's highly unlikely that I go to a standard deck of cards and I randomly select a king and then an ace. That probability makes sense based on the fact that I know more than likely I'm not going to get two cards like that back to back. Could happen, right? But I would expect that probability to be low. Because typically if I go to a deck of cards, I don't really get, and I randomly choose two cards, I don't really get a king and then an ace. I want to make sure you understand the difference between, you know, what I did here because I'm selecting one card and what I did here because I'm selecting two cards, even though the notation is still given and conditional. Do you see the difference? Ask me questions if you have one. Let me check in the chat too, just to make sure. Okay. I'm gonna expand on this. You have a problem in your assignment that says you are given the probability of some event A as 0.3. You don't know what A is, you just know that. You're given the probability of event B is 0.6. You don't know what event B is, you just know that that's the probability of it. And you're given, this is all given, probability of A and B is 0.10. You don't know what they are, this is given. You just know those probabilities. That's all you know, that's 0.6. And you are asked to find the probability of B given A. So as you can clearly see, just based on the fact that you have no idea what the events are, you have no choice but to use the actual formula. So this is an example of where they force you to use the formula without really telling you to use the formula. But You can still do it, right? If I know what the events are, though, it becomes a little bit easier. So the probability of B given A is equal to the probability of B and A, the intersection, over the probability of A. That's my formula. Always the intersection of the two, and this is always the probability of what's already occurred. And it just so happens that I have everything already, because I know the probability of B and A. The probability of B and A occurring at the same time is the same thing as the probability of A and B occurring at the same time. It's the intersection of the two. So this is 0.10. And I know the probability of A because they gave it to me. It's 0.3. And so 0.1 divided by 0.3, 0.3333, and this is my probability, approximately. Round to four digits. So you see how they force you to use the formula in that situation. However, you don't necessarily have to in other situations because you wouldn't know what the events are. This one, you have no idea what the events are. All you know is what's given, the probabilities. Does that make sense? This is why I show the formula, because of the fact that you have these questions. You have a couple of them. Do you have questions? Does it make sense?
So that question just kind of gave extra fluff in a way.
Yeah, it was just, it was like indirectly saying, go ahead and use the formula, practice it. I know a lot of people get all like twisted up because they don't know what A and B is, but technically you don't have to, as long as you have everything that you need within the formula. Then they gave you that. Does that make sense? Let's see, I have. So wait, questions yet? I'm bouncing around a little bit to see what's on this. Probability, so I want to do some of these long ones too. All right, here. Let me give you this one. I'll come back to some stuff. I want to do the probability of at least one also while I can, because of the fact that that is always a pain in the butt. But however, where's my thing? Hold on 1 second. Let me get my chat. It's me. This is what I want. And I'm going to take that and go here. Boom. I want to show you how you do the same thing, right? This may or may not be conditional. I'm not indicating conditional or not. I just want to do a problem with a lot of words in it that makes people uncomfortable. And then I'm going to figure out which rule it is. Okay. We'll see together. When doing blood testing for a viral infection, the procedure can be made more efficient and less expensive by combining partial samples and different blood specimens. If samples from 4 people are combined and the mixture tests negative, we know that all 4 individual samples are negative. Find the probability of a positive result for 4 samples combined into 1 mixture. Assuming the probability of an individual blood sample testing positive for the virus is 0.7. This is the perfect problem to do to warm me up into the next thing. Let's interpret what the heck this says. First of all, there's a lot of words, but I see this number and I want to figure out what that number means. Let's start there. The probability of an individual blood sample, 1 blood sample testing positive, is 0.07. Probability of a positive result testing positive is 0.07. This is for 1 person. But because we know complementary events, I know that it's either positive or negative. I can determine the probability for 1 person if they have a negative result, because it's the complement of that. It's everything but that. So 1 minus that, or 0.93. All I did was first start by saying, what does this number mean? And they told me that it's the probability of an individual, one person, blood sample testing positive. Now, we know that if we take four people and mix them together, four people's in a mixture, it's not proper English, but you know, four person mixture, that's more proper. A four person mixture, all have to be negative for the mixture to be negative. Right? All have to be negative for the mixture to be negative. Right? If samples from four people are combined and the mixture tests negative, we know that everyone is negative. That makes sense, right? But then that would have to be true. If I have a mixture of four people with results and that whole mixture is negative, then nobody can be positive, right? Because I wouldn't get a negative result for a combination of more than one. But that's not what I'm asked to do. But let's just interpret some things. I know that for a four-person mixture to be positive, for A, at least one person must be positive. Tell me if that makes sense. For a four-person mixture to be positive, they all don't have to be positive. Only one of them has to be positive, or two, or three, or four. I don't know. It doesn't matter. At least one of them. Four or more. At least one person. One or more. One or more. One or two or three or four. So, as long as we understand that part, now we have to figure out what they're asking me to, which is probably find the probability of a positive result for four samples. Find this probability. Find the probability of that. Find the probability that you have a four-person mixture and it's positive. But it's only positive if at least one person is positive. So in other words, find the probability that at least one of the four is positive. Does that make sense? This is me breaking down a word problem. Let's read it again. When doing blood testing for a viral infection, the procedure can be made more efficient and less expensive by combining partial samples of different blood specimens. I'm mixing up people's stuff. If samples from four people I'm looking at, are combined and mixed, and that mixture tests negative, then we know that all four individual samples are negative. Let me stop and think about that. That makes sense. If I have four people mixed together and their results altogether are negative, then they all should probably be negative, okay? That makes sense. I wrote that down. I have it down for my notation, you know, just to look back if I need to, right? Find the probability of a positive result for four samples. I'm gonna stop right there. Find the probability of a positive result for four samples. They just told me that all of them have to be negative to be negative. So if the mixture is positive, then at least one of them is positive. At least one. It could be one or two or three or four of them. So this is what I wrote down for that, and this is what I want. That's what I determined, that's what I want. Right? And then they gave me this stuff, assuming the probability of an individual. So I broke it down piece by piece. You see how I did that? That is very important. That process of breaking down, you know, what the heck this stuff is asking you to do. Yeah, I'll send you the link after, or I'll drop it in here after. You know, what is happening in the, all those words? That is very important. You're gonna have a lot of word problems in this course. Okay, we have to get used to it. But do you see how I did it piece by piece? I really ignored the rest of it and I focused on one portion at a time. And I dealt with that portion and I made sure that portion made sense to me. I didn't find the answer yet, but at least I understand what I'm looking for. And I do have some information. Now, I have not talked about this yet. This is the fun stuff. At least one. When I see that, now I know I'm finding the probability of at least one. I haven't talked about that yet, and I'm about to. Does this interpretation of what this says make sense?
Yes.
Okay, good. Anyone else? Any questions before I move on? We're good? So I want you to notice before I even go into calculation, when I have four people and I want at least one positive, that means one or more. That means one is positive, one of them, or two of them, or three of them, or four are positive. Those are all the situations that can happen when I say at least one. One of them is positive, or two of them is positive, or three of them, or four. That's the only scenario such that the mixture would be positive. But there's a lot of situations here. At least one, all right? This is like the probability that one of them is positive, plus, because anytime I do or, I do addition. The probability that two of them is positive, or the probability that three of them is positive, or the probability of four of them. That's a lot of calculation, by the way. And it is quite difficult because within each calculation, order matters. And so it would be a pain in the butt to do each one of these separately. As you get into binomial probability distribution, it becomes a little bit easier, but there is an easier way to do the probability of at least one. Let me ask you this. Let's see if anybody catches this. What is missing from this? If I think about all the possible outcomes, right? When I have a group of four samples mixed together, right? Or four people and their results mixed together. And I talked about how many of them are positive. I talked about one of them being positive out of the four, two of them being positive out of the four, three of them being positive out of the four, or all of them being positive. There's one thing that I did not talk about. Do you know what that is?
The ones that were negative?
None of them being positive. Zero of them being positive. Agree with me that if I include 0, 1, 2, 3, and 4, that is the total sample space. Those are all the possible outcomes of this situation. But this is the complement of all of these. Remember complementary events. When I take, you know, one event and I talk about everything but that event, together they create the total sample space. And this is one event. All of these together is one event, one kind of situation, right? At least one of them is positive. This is the event that I get a positive mixture. Because, you know, it could be one of them being positive or two or three or four. But at the end of the day, all these are going to give me positive if I mix four results together. So this is the complement of that. Let me write that. Complement. Events. And anytime we do complementary events, they add up to one. So if I do one minus this complementary event, it is the same as calculating this sum. Tell me if that makes sense. That's the part where sometimes we get tripped up. Tell me if that makes sense. Because if not, I didn't calculate anything yet. I'm just talking about understanding what the heck this is. But I'm telling you, doing one calculation versus four is going to be much easier. This is simplifying my calculation of this. And this little portion here is simply saying 1 minus the probability that none are positive, all are negative. Right? 0 positive, all negative. And that's 4 people, right? And this is me taking the question and converting it into now mathematical notation, right? But within each, you know, situation, I can convert from the notation back to words if I have to, right? You know, if I don't understand P of 0, I'm going to write for myself 0 positive, which means all negative. Whatever I need to do to help myself. This is still the same thing as finding this. I'm just converting all of this and trying to make my life easier. So now the only calculation that I really have to do is figure out the probability of all of them being negative. Well, I need numbers now. And I do know the probability that one person has a negative result. And that probability that one person has a negative result is 0.93. But I want all of them to be negative. So the first person negative, the second person negative, the third person negative, right? Because remember, this is a mixture of 4 people, and all of them have to be negative to have 0 positive. But they're independent events because the probability of each would be, you know, independent of another. So I could potentially just say 0.93 to the fourth power. And look at that. There's nothing left to input. Now it's just the calculator thing. 1 minus 0.93 to the fourth power. We're running to 4 probably. 0.2519. Approximately 0.2519. There is a 25.19% chance that I go to this group, any particular sample, a mixture of 4 people's results. There's a 25.19% chance that at least one of the 4 is positive. That's actually pretty high. That's pretty high. But at least one indicates that one of them could be positive, or 2 of them, or 3 of them, or 4 of them. So what you just did here, or what we just did here, was we indicated, or we found the probability of at least one. And the probability of at least one of anything is always 1 minus the probability of none of that. Always. And the reason that we're using this, like, think of this as a formula. Anytime I hear that I'm asked to find the probability of at least one of something, I'm automatically going to write, well, that's 1 minus the probability of none of that, because it's going to make my calculation easier, right? Rather than doing 4 of these, I only had to do 1. And using complementary events, that's why this works, because the complement of at least one is none. But I know that complementary events come together, and give me the total of 1 or 100% of the situation. Okay, I'm gonna do another one. There's a lot of ways. This is another one I'm gonna switch it up a little bit, actually. Let me copy and paste this. I'm gonna put it in here, actually, just because you guys, I'm gonna use it. All right. So let's do another one. Do you have questions yet? Is this making sense? This one is you know. Why didn't that show up? Come on, seriously, guys. Seriously. All right. I'm gonna change it a little bit just to make it different. Whatever. Okay. In a large population, 62% of the people have been vaccinated. If six people are randomly selected, what is the probability that at least one of them have been vaccinated? Now, personally, I've done enough of at least one to know that whenever I see at least one, probability that at least one is vaccinated, I'm always going to go, this is the same thing as one minus the probability of zero or none vaccinated. That's a zero. So technically, one minus the probability of, you know, all six of them being unvaccinated. Now, I jumped to that just because of the fact that I heard at least one. The moment I hear at least one, I'm going straight to that. But, you know, at the end of the day, if I have six people and I'm talking about at least one of them being vaccinated, this is the same thing as saying, well, exactly one of them are vaccinated, or two of them, or three of them, or four of them, or five of them, or six of them being vaccinated. That's a pain in my butt to do all that. Zero is the complement of that, right? It's the only one not included out of the total sample space. So I would rather do one calculation than six of them, personally, which is why this whole formula-ish thing makes my life much easier. But it uses the concept of complementary events to basically indicate that it's correct, right? So now I have to figure out how to determine the probability that all six are unvaccinated. And I know they're independent events. And just like here, I had four. So I had to do it to the fourth power. I'm going to have it to the sixth power because there's six people here. This is me just setting up. But I have to figure out what the probability of one of them being unvaccinated is. So let's go back up here, and I'm given more information. 62% of the people have been vaccinated. So if I have one person that I'm randomly selecting from a group of people, the probability that they are vaccinated, that one person, is 0.62. So that is another way of giving me the probability of one person, in this particular case, being vaccinated. But if I know the probability of one person being vaccinated, I know the probability of one person not being vaccinated. Talking about one person. It's whatever is outside of this, whatever's the complement of that. So 0.38. That's just for one person. But now I know what the probability of one person being unvaccinated is. All I need is that all six of them being unvaccinated. So 0.38 to the sixth power. And 0.38 times 0.38 to the first person. It's like, this is like the multiplication rule within this other rule. Because technically it's more than one person. 1 minus 0.38 to the sixth. 1 minus 0.38 to the sixth power. 0.99. Okay, so look, I'm rounding to 4. And when I go 0.9969, this is going to make this go up. And 9 can't go to 10, so now I'm going to go over here. So 0.9970, approximately. Rounding to the nearest. So this is highly likely. This is not... This is 99.7%. Sorry, it's bothering me how my 9 is coming out. And I keep doing the same thing over and over again. Okay, there we go. 99.7% chance. And this, look, 99.7, we're technically round up to 100, but we never ever round to 100 because that is always a certain event, right? And we're never talking about a certain event unless we know what's going to happen. This is highly likely, but there is a probability of it not happening also. But this is telling me that I go to a random group of 6 people and at least one of them is vaccinated. That doesn't mean all of them are. That means only one of them out of the 6, or 2 of them out of the 6, or 3 of them out of 6, or 4 of them. That makes sense that that would be highly likely if 62% of the population is vaccinated. I would expect to go to a group of 6 people and get at least one of them being vaccinated. You could think of that nowadays. You grab a group of 6 people, at least one of them are probably vaccinated. Probably with the COVID vaccination, if we're talking about our current situation. Check in chat. Tell me if that makes sense. Because sometimes the probability of at least one can throw people for a loop. Oh yeah. Questions? Yay, okay, understanding. I like that. Okay. So the probability of at least one is not bad, but it can be confusing, right? If you don't just simplify the concept, make it light. Anytime I see find the probability of at least one, I'm going straight to this. Probability of at least one is 1 minus probability of none, of whatever it is. Now, at this point in time, I might just pick random stuff from this situation here and just do them, because now I have covered everything, but now I can get like a little more detailed, I guess. Let me see what we got here. Both have the C. So, I don't know. Randomly pick something here. I might do this one because it has a few different questions. Good. I like that. All right. So here, we'll do this one because there's where is it? Here. We'll do this one because it's a few different questions in one. And I remember you saying something about the addition rule popping up in this assignment, and you're right. It does, like in this. And it's possible that you have like an intersection that you have to subtract, meaning you might have non-mutually exclusive events. I don't know, we'll see. I don't know. I haven't even read it yet. Let's read it together. So I have, a jar containing 30 red marbles, and they're numbered 1 to 30, okay? And 38 blue marbles numbered 1 to 38. Well, this is interesting. So I have 30 red, and they're number 1 to 30. Oh, you know what? Let's color coordinate. 30 red, 1 to 30. And then 38 blue, numbered 1 to 38. So each one of them have a color and a number corresponding to them. A marble is drawn at random from the jar. Find the probability of the given event. probability that it's red. Okay, so I have a bag or a jar of marbles, and I really only have 30 red or 30 blue if I'm just talking colors. So I'm gonna say, let's do purple. I'm gonna say I have a total of 30 plus 38 or 68 marbles, right? I always wanna talk about total. How many total do I have? So I have 68 total marbles. So I know that this is just one marble I'm selecting, a marble, very important, only selecting one. And that marble wants to be red. So how many total red? I have 30 total red out of 68 total marbles. And so I'm only selecting one, not multiplying anything, not subtracting anything, because there's no or case, there's no and case, there's no conditional case. That's it, 30 out of 68. 30 out of 68. Sometimes what happens when I show all these different scenarios, it's like, oh man, the basic stuff is confusing again. 0.441, sorry, 2 if I'm rounding properly. Oh, sorry, please enter reduced fractions. Oh. Well, I'm gonna let my calculator do that. 30 out of 68, then I go to math, frac, and it's going to take the last answer and convert it to a fraction, and it's gonna reduce it for me, 15 out of 34. Done. All right, so reduced fractions. Oh, now the marble is odd numbered. So I'm not looking at colors, I'm looking at, you know, the numbers, odd numbered. So it doesn't matter if it's red or blue this time, it just matters the number. Okay, I'm still out of 68 total marbles, but how many are odd? So the first set is numbered 1 to 30, and half of those are odd. So let's count that. And the second group is numbered 1 to 38, and half of those are odd. Okay, 19, I knew that one. I just wanted to make sure. So there are 15 plus 19, let's do that in here, 15 plus 19 out of 68. I don't have to convert that to a fraction, but I'll show you again how to do it. Math, frac. And it will convert the last decimal to a fraction, a reduced fraction, which obviously we know is 1/2. So 34 out of 68, or 1/2. Keep it in fraction form because they asked me to. Ooh, this one is good. So I'm gonna go up here, and I'm gonna, because I see that I want red or odd now. So let's, I have 34 odd. And so I have 34 even, right? I'm going to put that up there for my reference, because obviously I have to deal with some addition rule stuff here, which could be confusing because there's definitely an intersection. Now, or. Anytime I see the or case, I go addition rule. So I'm going to focus on just this by itself, this by itself, and then I'm going to subtract the intersection, because that's what the addition rule tells me to do. Ooh, where the heck it was, wherever the heck I wrote it. Somewhere up here, back in, yeah, right? The or case, right? Focus on the probability of the first, then add to that the probability of the second, and subtract if there is an intersection. If there's no intersection, they're mutually exclusive, then it's just simplifying your calculation, right? So let's do that. Start with just red. I have 30 red. Color coordinating, 30. Red plus odd. I wrote my odd, let's say I did that in green. So I have 34 odd. But I definitely know that I do have some odd red, right? Let's do that maybe in pink. So the odd numbers that are red were counted in my group of red, and then they were also counted here, so I have to subtract some of them. So how many are red and odd? I'm gonna write that here. Red and odd. So I have 30 red marbles in total, and half of them are odd. So let's subtract that intersection, and it's still out of the total 68, right? There's no conditional case. There's no multiplication. There's no and. There's no. So that's it. Do it all on the calculator. 30 plus 34 minus 15, whatever that is, 49. Here, I'll write that too. 49 out of 68, but I want it as a reduced fraction, which I could reduce by hand, or I could just cheat and let my calculator do it. This is the decimal version of it. Convert it, math, to a fraction. 49 out of 68, so it does not simplify any more than that. Okay. Cool, another OR case, addition rule. Long fraction bar, out of the total. I know I'm gonna focus on blue, then I'm gonna focus on even, and then I'm gonna subtract the intersection if I have it. So I'm gonna set myself up. I have how many total blue? 38 blue. I have how many total even? Let's put that in green. We already said we have 34 total even, but how many are blue and even? Let's write that here, blue and even. So I had 38 total blue, and half of that is even. I'm gonna simplify. 38 plus 34 minus, what did I say, 19 out of 68. That looks like it's not gonna simplify. Oops, 53 out of 68. 53 is an ugly number. So, I don't know, let me make one up. Three marbles are selected. Find the probability that all three are blue. So a probability, all three are blue. Now I'm selecting more than one marble. So I know I'm gonna multiply, and I'm gonna multiply three of them because I'm selecting three. But I want to know if the values are going to decrease or change or not, because I have to think about whether it's with or without replacement. And typically, if you're not told, you're going to assume without. So we're going to assume without replacement. Okay, which means that I have dependent events, and I would expect, you know, the values to change. Probability that the first is blue, let's go back up. How many are in blue? 38 total blue. 38 blue out of 68 total. The second one being blue, if I didn't replace the first one, there's only 37 now blue out of 67. And if I didn't replace the first two blue, now there's only 36 blue out of 66. And obviously we're not gonna leave that as a fraction. We're gonna, this one, usually with the multiplication rule, we 38 out of 68, you put it in decimal form because you get big numbers, 37 out of 67, and then 36 out of 66. Let me see what that fraction looks like. Sometimes it's a crazy fraction that they just keeps it in decimal form, 0.168. Yeah, so usually, because obviously these numbers are going to get big very fast, so we're not going to leave that in fraction form. So anyway, I just wanted to discuss, there's one thing, where is it, one more thing real quick before I stop this. Where did I put the multiplication rule? We're kind of used to this. The probability of A and B happening is equal to the probability of A times the probability of B. This is what we're naturally doing. Like we just did a situation where we did the probability of selecting all blue. And that's what this is. We multiply the probability of the first case, the probability of the second case, given the first case has already happened, and then you would continue that depending on how many you need to pick. So this is just in mathematical notation saying what we just did. If they're independent, you know, you're just multiplying the two cases, right? The reason that I showed that was just real quick. This one from your just quick example. You're given probability of A is 0.54, probability of A and B, this is your and, is 0.01, and you're asked to find probability of B, right? So another situation where they kind of force you to use a formula, but they do tell you that A and B are independent. Which means that I can use this probability, using the probability of A and B is just simply the probability of A times the probability of B because they're independent events. And I have all that, right? little algebra to manipulate this because I want B. So if I want to isolate this, I would divide by that. So the probability of B would be the probability of A and B divided by the probability of A, right? Because I would have to divide both sides by P of A to get P of B by itself. And I have everything I need because this is given. And this is given, so it's really just plug and chug. Whenever you have, you know, the ones where they ask you about the formulas and such, it's plug and chug, 0.0185, 0.01, okay? That's it. You know, if the two events are mutually exclusive, then there is no intersection, this would be zero. And therefore the whole thing would be zero. I think there was a question at the end of the first assignment where it kind of like, maybe I'll do that too, just to make sure. I'm trying to cover everything because I don't have a session this Friday. So I just want to make sure before I stop. I'm going to stop after this. But you have P of E. My kids are loud. You can hear all the noise I'm making. And you're asked for this. And you're told that E and F are, I'm gonna say ME, mutually exclusive. And anytime I see mutually exclusive, I go, okay, there's no intersection. Now, typically we don't see the term mutually exclusive with the given situation, but conditional probability, right? I have so many notes here. Conditional probability, I'm seeing formula stuff. So I'm just gonna, let's copy and paste this and bring it down there just to refer back to that. Okay, this is my formula. Oops. Just in the box. But instead of A and B, it's E and F. So just changing the variables a little bit. So E is taking the place of A and F is taking the place of B. Doesn't really E and F. Over the probability of F, right? Doesn't make a difference what, you know, variables I use. I look at this and I go, okay, now I'm confused because I have P of F, I have that, but I don't have the intersection of the two. So now it's like, well, how do I find this? Well, that means this is a big part. The fact that they're mutually exclusive is a big part of finishing this. And because they're mutually exclusive, there is no intersection, that is zero. And it doesn't even matter what down here is because anything zero divided by anything is zero. So, you know, I have a formula situation, but they don't give me everything I need. That means that what they're telling me is how to finish it. All right, I gotta stop this recording because it's